Hi there, Frank Winston here for the Pacifica Historical Society and host of our weekly show, Footprints of Pacifica, where we discover and explore the lure and lore of lovely Pacifica, its character and its characters. This week's show focuses on a unique area of Pacifica known as Shelter Cove. And we will hear from Lenore Lafayette in person, describing what it was like growing up in that area. But we've first proceeded with a television show based upon a meeting of the Pacifica Historical Society in 1997, where three of the residents from different generations described what it was like living on Shelter Cove. Roll the tape, please.
Feeling about Shelter Cove, and now when I look at it, it's kind of sad because I remember it the way it was. And on weekends, a lot of people came down. The people used to be coming down that road back of the Lewis house. They'd be easing their way down that road, and you know, there was a lot of traffic, and people would be down for barbecues and swimming and fishing. A lot of fishing there. My grandfather was a wonderful fisherman, and so was my uncle. Not my father, he didn't like to fish, but you know, he enjoyed everything else there. But we had fun, we had fun. We had a table in that porch, and it was on sawhorses. And it was probably twice as long as this. It was tremendous. I never saw a table as big as that. And it ran the full width of the porch. And then there were benches all along, so no matter who came, who of the family showed up, because we never really knew who was coming, there was plenty of room, you know? It was great. So the simple times, we had no TV, no radio, nothing. You were down there and you had to enjoy nature. And you know, what's wrong with that? It's wonderful. It makes you feel good. Just a wonderful place for a child to grow up.
I'm Charlotte Papka Kaiser, the oldest daughter of Charles and Mary Papka. And seems like we had an overlap in years here that I guess I wasn't aware of, and neither were you.
Right.
Anyway, I we had been coming down since 1941, mostly just to pay rent to Mr. Lewis or to buy ice creams. Of course, at that time, as you mentioned, electricity was in after we, you know, were down there. But anyway, utilities were sporadic, and you certainly didn't have the luxury of a freezer. And so ice cream was really a very special treat to us. And Mr. Bloom had a store at Pedro, and Mr. Lewis had ice creams available at Shelter Cove. So you know where we went from one to the other. But we finally located down there in the spring of 1949, and I resided there until, I guess it was 1973, with just a small break in there where we had left and moved away. As was said before, it is still a special place, but for children it was wonderful. And there was nothing about locking doors, locking windows. There was always something to do. Of course, I have to say I complained once in a while. Maybe there was a little too much to do because everything was done by hand. We had gas utilities put in 1950, and before that you either brought your wood down, because of course there was a lot of lumbering going on the coast, and there were piles of wood that would wash in, but it didn't take long. There were 22 homes there, and so you could go through a winter supply of wood quite quickly. And other than kerosene heaters, which are, I'm not sure many people are aware of, but they smell terrible and they made an awful mess in your house, but they did provide heat. And that's about the only, you know, heat that we had, other than little foot heaters that were electrical. And of course, when you had storms, you didn't have that either because the electricity went out. I never had to go through kerosene lanterns, but I have used them. Even in Pacifica today, I keep a ready supply. I've brought some pictures that show the crowds of people that were an everyday, or I should say every weekend, event down there. We had a lot of people from all nationalities would come down. They found plentiful supplies of fish, lots of abalones, beautiful, beautiful fresh abalone, that even the kids, I mean, I can remember my mother going and saying, it's low tide, go out and get some abalone. It wasn't anything unusual. They're very rare. They're very rare now, and people have just abused that. I'm not sure that they've had a chance to replenish in the last, say, 20 years down at Shelter Cove, but they were overfished. The fish themselves are not as plentiful as you had mentioned. I think there are a couple pictures around here that were just everyday catches, nothing unusual. And you can see by the number of the fish that our supplies of all kinds of animals have, or I should say seafood, has disappeared. But it was great for kids. I mean, you could go out there, take your pole out or your iron for your abalone. As far as the ocean, it was clear and clean. The only time we had problems was when a tanker or sometimes even a freighter would come by and they would discharge the bilge, and that would get to kind of mix up with the ocean chemicals, and then you would get these globs of oil, and everybody hated that because there was the only one way to get it off, and that was kerosene, and that burned like heck. So you as a kid would take sand and anything else to try to get it off before mama saw you.
The bathing suits.
Oh, the bathing suits, the beach balls, everything. And you better not track it into the house. Yeah.
Well, my name is Jenny Jacob, and I will tell you a little bit about my history with Shelter Cove, which actually I think covers about a decade. I must tell you that when I moved in to Shelter Cove in 1966, I paid $80 a month rent. And anyway, I lived there Let's see, my husband Robin joined me in about 1971 or 72, and we continued to live in 16 Shelter Cove until about 1976 when we built our house up on Peter Point, and so we moved at that point. I also have to tell you that when we moved out of Shelter Cove, we were paying $150 a month. I guess there's just there are probably two or three really vivid, I was trying to think about what memories I could share with you, and remembrances of Shelter Cove I could share with you, and there are two or three that I remember. One was a small tidal wave that happened in, I think, 1972 or 1973. Charles might remember. It was just a very small one. We had had a kind of tsunami alert, and so we were sort of prepared. We moved cars. Most people moved cars up to the top. And I had gone to work, and later on, left work, came home after work to find, as Charles was saying, rocks. The entire area completely covered by huge boulders. I mean, huge boulders. And it was at that point that I gained great respect for the ocean, to think that I mean, it would take cranes to move those boulders. And one wave had come in and just replaced all of that rock that was out on the beach levee out to all of our houses. There was not a great deal of structural damage during that time. I do remember one van that was parked next door, actually about where we live, and the wave literally picked it up and smashed it against one of the pylons, and so it looked like a tin can that had just been kind of crushed, and that was a vivid recollection of mine. The other recollection that I have of Shelter Cove that is vivid in my memory, the sound was just wonderful. Just always go to bed with this constant churning of rocks and of the water and of the ocean, and it was really a very calm and wonderful place. One of the things I loved about it so much was that as you drove out, and in those days you could drive out, and you went around the point and down into Shelter Cove, you were removed from everything else that had happened. You had this sense of being removed from work and all of the problems that existed there and from the rest of the world, and you were in a very, very special place. Very, very special little place.
See, we were sheltered. You know, I think they named it Shelter for a reason. But it was a fascinating place, you know.
Down along the coast, we walked together hand in hand. Everybody watching us say goodbye knows we're in love. Yes, they understand.
And welcome to our studio guest, Lenore Lafayette, who wrote the definitive book about Shelter Cove based not only on her research and history, but her own personal reminiscences. How did you come to write the book?
Well, I was taking a writing class at one of the colleges in my area in Santa Clara Valley, and they asked for a topic. When was the happiest time of your life? And I could really say that was it, you know, when I was a child and we used to go to Shelter Cove.
When you grew up, you didn't live at Shelter Cove.
No.
But the summertime, that was the happening.
Right.
Where were you growing up at?
San Francisco.
Okay, and your father worked in San Francisco?
Yes, he was a policeman.
But your story of Shelter Cove really precedes that with your grandfather and grandmother. Could
right.
you tell us about them?
Yeah. Well, they were immigrants from Sicily, and they first came to New Orleans, and then an uncle said that Chicago was the place to be. You know, there was money to be made in Chicago, so they moved to Chicago. Well, one winter in Chicago was it. They couldn't stand the cold. So they came to California, and when my grandfather saw San Francisco, he said, it's just like Sicily. You know, the hills and coming down to the bay, he said it was exactly like Sicily.
What year did they move to Shelter Cove?
Well, they never moved. They always lived in San Francisco, too. But there again, they came down there, you know, when the family went down.
If someone were to locate Shelter Cove, because it still exists with the cottages today, driving down Highway 1, where would they look to the right, if you will, and how far down?
Well, of course, you have Pacifica now, you know, but in those days you didn't. Highway 1 is the way we used to come, and
that's before the freeway.
Before the freeway, yes. Okay. And it was very rural, you know.
What's the life like there today, the people who are living at Shelter Cove? They still have cottages, some people?
They still have cottages, but they have to haul things down. You know, if they buy groceries, they have to be hauled down there, you know, and if they need furniture or a new appliance, a new refrigerator or something, it has to be hauled down, you know.
So it's even more rustic than it was in
right,
your day.
Right, but some people
no
enjoy that, you know.
No automobiles.
No,
no roads
and
to go on.
I understand artists and writers like it there, you know, for the solitude, which I can well understand that.
Now, part of its history was called Smuggler's Cove. It's the same
right.
area. What happened during that generation?
Yeah. Well, that pertains to the Prohibition years, you know, and the illegal ships would be out in the waters there, outside of Shelter Cove, and they would have, of course, illegal liquor, and the people from shore used to either come out there or else they'd bring it in, and it was stashed in the old Ocean Shore Tunnel that was abandoned. And finally, the federal agents found out about that, and they took care of the tunnel.
By blowing it up. You can tell us also, there was a prohibition on you even going to the tunnel. Can you tell us now, did you ever sneak a peek at the tunnel before?
Oh, yeah, sure. When you're a kid, naturally, when you're told to stay away from something, that's where you want to go. And it was scary.
When the tunnel was built, it was to accommodate the Ocean Shore Railroad?
Yes.
Which, that terminated in 1920.
Right.
But the fight over the land that it had been used on went on to the 60s and 70s.
Oh, yeah, until 1970.
And
yeah.
the investment company was still in there, the Ocean Shore.
Yeah.
Road. Okay. What kinds of happenings you mentioned in the video about the dances and everybody would sleep out on the porches, but not necessarily on the beach. What other activities did you remember that were key for you, special?
Well, for us, you know, we're a big family, and one of my uncles had a harmonica, and my father used to have a Jewish harp, and he'd bring that down. He'd bring down drumsticks, and everybody sang. I have one aunt that used to sing torch songs. And everybody had their own little talent, you know, you know.
It was populated during the summertime, or did some people live in the cottages year-round and even today?
A few people, I think, did live in the cottages year-round, but they were very secretive. You know, I wondered sometimes what type of goings-on were happening in those cottages. There were a few people that we saw just occasionally.
In addition to the cottages, you also had summer traffic, strangers.
Yes.
What impelled them to come down? Why was it a popular
place? Well, it was like a small Santa Cruz, and it was close to San Francisco.
It had no commercial ventures and no pier or things of that nature?
No, you brought your own picnic, whatever it was going to be, and some of them barbecued. There were barbecue pits there.
I noticed a photograph from your book. There are several, but one shows is this the one that shows the cottage that you came and visited often?
Yes.
And can you point that out? Or
the one on the left there.
And you slept sometimes 30, 35 people at one?
Oh, I mean, I don't know how many. Some of them went home at night. They didn't stay, but we always stayed.
And as far as who was coming, you literally, your family never
knew. You never knew. And I used to love to look. As soon as we'd get to the top of that hill, I'd be looking out the window to see whose car was there, you know, because then I could figure which cousins I had to play with.
Well, you had also, you visited many times, you told me, the remnants of the Tobin Station, which we have a picture of here.
Yes.
Now, was that a open as a railroad. The railroad had closed, but when did this convert to a home, if you recall?
You know, that must have been later after we were going there, because I don't really know when it became a home. I was quite surprised that it was a home, you know.
When you say you stopped, when did you terminate literally going there? Something happened?
Well, when my dad passed away, we didn't go down much after that.
And that was in 47?
Yes.
But the home still stood, or the cottage, if you will.
Yes.
Till about 1960, and then something occurred.
Yeah, the terrible storm, and you know, the beach at that time I was going there, the beach was covered with all these big boulders. You can see them in some of these pictures. Mm-hmm. And if you want to hold up the picture.
Please.
Yeah, you see the rocks. If you wanted to go to the beach, you had to climb over those rocks, and some of them were pretty big. Well, this terrible storm that happened, the boulders flew up in the air and hit the hill in back of our house and bounced back. And when they bounced back, they sliced the house open like a watermelon. It just went like that. And they went right through my grandmother's pantry. I'm glad my grandmother wasn't living to see that.
So no longer habitable.
Oh, no, it had to be taken down piece by piece.
And how's it operated today? Does people rent? I know in the video they talked about renting it for $300 or $100 and so on. What is it today, if you know?
Well, it's privately owned.
The entire shelter, the area called Shelter?
Yes, a gentleman who used to live in Los Altos bought it, and he does rent the houses out.
Does he live there? That's Mr. Lewis?
No, the man that has it now. Yes. His name is Arno, but I'm sorry, I've forgotten his last name. Rostov, I think it is. He rents the cottages out.
So he owns the entire property, including the beach. Now, does the Golden Gate National Recreation Area or the Coastside Commission or anybody have any jurisdiction over it? Or he's literally the owner, but if he wants to make any changes, he has
that
to go to the
That seems strange to me. It just seems that, you know, I thought that any coastal land had to have a way that public could have access to it.
Right.
But that's not the case here. You can't go down there. It's no trespassing.
Well, there's a sign that says no trespassing.
Yeah,
but
and you better not.
Will the sheriff be coming, or someone over the Pacifica Police?
Right.
It's really off limits.
Yeah.
Okay. And were there any other special events that occurred every year, like would they have a 4th of July happening, and that was a special
4th of July was one of the biggest times. Yeah, we had a lot of people down there. And it'd be ink black, no stars or nothing. I can remember. And we'd have these fireworks, and they would just light up the sky. And oh my gosh, it was just so much fun, you know.
If you could remember, probably do, because you mentioned some in the book, but one key event that you said, you know, just was spectacular for your memory and your growing up out there.
Oh, probably. There were more than one key events, but the barbecues. The barbecues were wonderful. My uncles were butchers. My mother's brothers, four of them were butchers. And they would bring the best meat down, you know, and it was...
Well, were these barbecues the entire community, or each cottage had their own space?
We had our own barbecue pit that they built, and it was made of stone, and it was about that high. And I used to hang around that barbecue pit and hang around, and finally somebody would say to me, how about a little taste?
How about the incorporation of Pacifica in 1957? You say you left shortly after that.
Yeah.
Did that make a difference to the people living in Shelter Cove, could you tell? Or they were sort of isolated from whatever was happening on the city, the highways, who cared? Once you were there,
yeah,
you were
it
there.
Was an isolated place. But of course, when Pacifica came into being, you know, stores came, and it was more like part of the city.
Stores came to Pacifica. Did stores come to Shelter Cove, or has that always been non-commercial?
No. Mr. Lewis had a store of sorts in his home there, and his house was like a ship. And it had like a gangplank going up. And then he had teak wood floors. And he had pictures of fishermen all around on the walls and a bell. It was very much like a ship.
But if it's like a ship, how did they get the supplies there? You describe it, they're right up against the ocean. You're not bringing it in from the boats to there.
Well, they just drove in with it, I guess.
They still had to go, because I've heard mention of the rope and the cable or whichever it was to help people get up and down from the mountains. And
yeah, well, that was when they were building the railroad. That's, we're talking about another...
Back in the 20s. So
yes.
Actually, it closed in the 20s, so even
before
that. Yeah,
so it was 1907 when
So anything that was going into Shelter Cove was dropped from the mountain down or carried down, and people had to carry up because they didn't have too many automobiles in the 1900s either.
Well, right, but now that's what they're doing again, isn't it? You know,
because
they don't have the roads, so they have to haul everything down that mountain and haul it all back out.
What about the trash? The same thing, or
I guess
dumping?
So.
Who knows? They may be dumping in the ocean.
Yeah.
We don't want to set there.
Well, there's a price to pay for what you want there, you know. And
have you been back there recently to see if any of the people who you used to spend time with in the summer are still coming out?
No, I don't go down there. I haven't been down there. I've seen it from the top of the hill,
mm-hmm.
you know, and it looks so different. I can hardly believe it's the same place.
Because of lack of people moving
around?
Well,
the road is gone.
Right, okay.
And the beach had all these huge boulders, as according to the picture there.
Mm-hmm.
You could see the boulders were all along here.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's none of that. What happened to all the boulders? I think, you know, how did they get those boulders out of there? They haul them up? I don't know.
The mystery.
Yeah.
The mystery of Shelter Cove and why people...
But the road is gone, too.
Well, it's been a delight sharing these times with you. I'm going to have to close the program, but I sure hope that people will try to see Shelter Cove if they can't or are scared to go down. They will at least find the book Shelter Cove, which is in libraries and also available from the Pacifica Historical Society. And remember, lives of great men all remind us we can make our lives sublime. And departing, leave behind us footprints in the sands of time.